And this is GLR, Greater London.
This is BBC London 94.9.
In tune with BBC Radio London, broadcasting with a radiated power of 17 kilowatts on a frequency of 95.3 megahertz from a transmitter at Rootham in Kent. If you're receiving us, please drop us a line to let us know. Our address is BBC Radio London, Harwood House, Hanover Square, London W1R OJD. This is a test transmission of BBC Radio London.
Radio London 206, London's great radio.
Hello and welcome to this special programme celebrating 40 years of BBC London with me, Tony Blackburn. Over the next hour, we'll be hearing from the producers, presenters and editors that worked on the station during its 40-year history. Radio London launched on October the 6th, 1970, the first local radio station in London, originally broadcasting on 95.3 FM from studios in Hanover Square.
Radio London 206, Radio London 206, Radio London 206.
My name is Anne Kay. I was first of all a station assistant and then a producer and presenter on Radio London and GLR. I joined in 1974 and I was there till 1992. Hanover Square had triple glazing, but it wasn't very good triple glazing because you could hear the buses go past. It was a bit of a rickety old building. The newsroom was on the ground floor and the studios were on the first floor. And because the newsroom was downstairs, you get lots of out-of-breath newsreaders puffing up the stairs ready for their bulletins if they were running a bit late. We had the most enormous jack field where you had to plug things coming in and going out. And I never got the hang of that at all. And it was a complete mystery to me from the day I started to the day I left.
My name is Nick St. George. I was the arts editor at Radio London from, I think it must have been about 1983 through to just after GLR. I applied for a job as a station assistant, they were called in those days, which was a sort of general dog's body, but a brilliant training because you did a bit of presentation, a bit of production, continuity announcing, driving the desk, the equipment that gets the shows on air, so on and so forth.
I was due to go on attachment to Radio Bristol and suddenly Radio London rang up and said, would you like to come here? Because I'd been third in the job search for Radio London and one of the people had dropped out, so I came to Radio London instead. It's funny how things work. And as a Londoner, obviously, I was very happy to come to London.
Derek Amore was not only the manager of Radio London, but he was also my opera critic. And I have many, many, many memories of Fridays. We recorded the programme on a Friday lunchtime to go out over each weekend. And I was often waiting until late into Friday evening for Derek to produce his review.
It's all for you.
When I was at Radio London, I think the character that I remember more than anything else was the person in charge, Derek Amore, who was a real one-off, really, when you come to think of it. I mean, for instance, he used to go to meetings with a water pistol, and if he didn't like somebody, he'd just squirt them with the water pistol. Simple as that. I mean, this was the sort of man we were working for, but he was a terrific one-off personality, and I absolutely adored him. I thought he was great.
Well, my name is Gary Crowley, and I first joined Radio London probably back in about 1986, 1987. I'd been at Capital Radio for about 5 years. My initial memories of listening to Radio London as a kid would have been listening to Robbie Vincent's Saturday morning, Saturday lunchtime soul show. I mean, that really was one of the most important shows on air at the time. If you were into dance music, into soul music, I mean, I can remember myself and also friends who would sit it, you know, religiously by the radio with a cassette recorder at 11 o'clock and actually tape the 2-3 hour show. You know, not only was he a terrific presenter, but also very knowledgeable about the music, but would also play an impeccable, you know, selection of tunes. I mean, that really was must-listen-to radio, as far as I was concerned.
The Robbie Vincent Telephone Programme. 206 Radio London.
There was the Robbie Vincent Telephone Programme at lunchtime. That was great. I used to work on it sometimes, producing it with Robbie, who was a great laugh and great fun. We used to call him Mr. Grumpy in the office, but don't tell him I said that. And it used to be 2.5 days, 12 to 2:30, and the first hour or so was open line, and then you'd have a guest in the second half. So one day you'd have consumer advice, one day you'd have problem solving. We had a wonderful wildlife expert called Charlie Austin, who really, really looked the part. He used to come in and give advice on wildlife and how to deal with spiders and all sorts of things. And not only did he look the part, but you can imagine the wildlife nestling in his beard. And apparently his wife, when she used to trim his beard for him, used to put the trimmings out for the birds to make nests with.
In the 1981 Local Radio Awards, the top two categories were won by Radio London. Local Radio Personality of the Year is Robbie Vincent, the man with the most listened-to phone-in in London. You can listen to Robbie from 10 till 12:30 on weekdays. The Best Station Award has gone to Radio London, bringing you the best in music, news and information. Not third, not runner-up, but number one. The Local Radio Personality of the Year and Best Station Awards, both won by Radio London.
I remember one really memorable day on Robbie's programme. I'd seen this documentary about mothers who were parted from their babies at birth. You know, you hear stories about babies being found in trains and things. And cut a long story short, we did this on the open line, and I got a call from someone who said her mother had made her give up this baby at birth and she didn't know where the baby was, and it was 20-odd years ago. And then later on, we had a call from someone saying, I know where that baby is. And we reunited the mother and daughter, and the daughter was now married and had her own babies. We reunited them in the Radio London studios the day before Christmas. We had all the camera crews and everything there. And that was because I'd seen a programme on television the night before and we did it as a subject. So things like that, you know, actually changed people's lives.
A jingle from radio station WMCA New York, heard every fortnight on Wednesday evenings when Radio London and WMCA link up in what's become the first regular transatlantic series of phone-in programmes.
Well, you're the next caller. Hello.
Hello, Robbie.
Yes, what's your name?
Debbie.
Debbie. And where are you calling from, Debbie?
Forest Hill.
Forest Hill in southeast London. You sound like a little person. How old are you?
I'm 16.
16, you're a semi-little person. What's on your mind?
I wanted to know if American teenagers do spend a lot of their time in hamburger bars and coffee bars after school.
In those days, we recorded interviews out on location on small portable reel-to-reel tape recorders called Ewers, marvellous devices. But you did have to thread up a piece of quarter-inch, old-fashioned quarter-inch tape onto the reels and then go out and record your interview. And I'd arranged an interview with David Hockney, who at that stage had just started to do his experimental photographs with Polaroids. And I must have been in a hurry to get there, London traffic, whatever. And I threaded the tape up the wrong way round. And I recorded an entire interview with David Hockney through the back of a piece of recording tape. Now, if you've ever done that, you'll know that the results are not terribly good. It tends to sound as if both of you have socks over your heads. And the interview with David Hockney sounds a bit like, one of the least glittering moments of my career.
I was the last person to broadcast from Hanover Square. It was a Sunday evening about 8 o'clock, and I said, you know, this is the last broadcast from us here in Hanover Square, and tomorrow we're opening bright new studios in Marylebone High Street, and good night from Hanover Square, blah, blah, blah. Switched off the microphone. 8 o'clock Sunday evening, I thought, I'm all alone in this building. And as I switched off the microphone, two men walked in and took my chair. And the next day, we had lots of studios, huge studio downstairs, Studio 2 for bands and things. And, you know, it was great fun.
The studios at Marylebone High Street, before the days of GLR and then BBC London, were in the basement. And actually, it was very civilised because you were away from the hubbub of the officers, the production officers and the newsroom, which were on the ground floor. There was a big studio with a piano in it in which one could do live music. And it was a little haven, really. Nowadays, so many studios are in the kind of centre of the operation of a radio station. There's people constantly coming and going. And whereas in the basement of Marylebone High Street, it was like a little quiet alcove in which one could get on and about one's business. 206 in the night.
The girls, that girl watchers watch their weight with 206 slimming tips.
My name's Kevin Siddle. I was an engineer at Radio London between 91 and 88. I became engineer in charge then in the last days of Radio London. And then I remained engineer in charge throughout the life of GLR. I was there at the beginning and there at the end of GLR. It was a little strange, really, because the concept of it, 1981 it was when it went stereo, of having a local radio station or any sort of radio station that was broadcasting mono, even then was a bit strange, but Radio London was the first one to go stereo. And that was 1981.
This is the end of programmes from Radio London for tonight. Don't forget, we'll be back tomorrow morning, stereo. That's from 6:30. And tomorrow evening, question time will be at the new time of 10 o'clock. So join us tomorrow, stereo day, at 6:30. In a few moments' time now, we join Radio 2 for the rest of the evening. From Radio London, good night.
The people got very, very excited about the fact it was going stereo, and all special precautions had to be taken so that the mono listener wouldn't be affected, and one thing or another. And if you consider the way we broadcast now, it's just accepted and no one really particularly worries about it. But it was a very big deal at the time.
And with that song from Peter Sellers and Sophie Loren, we leave Radio 2 and the early show with Bob Kilby. Good morning, this is BBC Radio London. And this morning, we're broadcasting in stereo on 94.9 VHF. Wednesday, the 11th of February, a date to remember and a new look, or should I say, a new sound for Radio London. John Waite and me, Susie Barnes, bring you, as usual, Rush Hour.
Radio London closed just before its 18th birthday, but the announcement was not met with open arms.
Radio London Stereo, London's greater radio.
The two men in charge of GLR were Matthew Bannister and Trevor Dan.
The first change we made, really, if I'm honest, was to very arrogantly assume that everybody who worked there before we arrived must be rubbish. I have seen this happen time and time again as I've grown older, and I've really regretted a lot of what we did then. But in truth, we were like the new management at a football team that had just been relegated. We just said, well, you've been relegated, so we'll hire a whole load of new people. So virtually everybody who was at Radio London was just allowed to go.
I'm Matthew Bannister. I was the managing editor of BBC Radio London and then GLR from 1988 to 1991. I think we went through a very difficult time for some of the people who'd been there a long time. One of the things that I did was I sat down and I gave everybody on the staff a chance to come and see me on their own and to tell me their ideas for the future of the radio station. So I had this whole series of 15-20 minute appointments with every single member of staff to see what their ideas were for the future, because I thought, you know, these are very talented people, they'll no doubt have some good ideas. And some people had some great ideas, and some people just didn't want to know and didn't want to play. So actually what we did was we promoted some of the most junior people into the senior positions for the new station. I don't think that went down very well with some of the people who've been here a long time. But my view was, either you've got to join in this project or we'll have to help you to move on. And obviously some people did have to leave, and that was very sad for them, and I'm no doubt that some of them were angry about it too. But we had to fulfil our brief, we had to do what the BBC had asked us to do, and we had to make sure that the people who were working here were fully committed and fully excited about what it was that we were going to do in the future.
Kevin Siddle.
It was quite bad, actually. I mean, to be honest, Trevor and Matthew performed a bit of a cull on the Radio London staff. Not many people made the transition certainly not after a couple of years, most of the Radio London people had gone. And whereas I think Trevor might unkindly say it's cutting out the dead wood, I think it wasn't so much that. It was just, it was a completely different mindset they were looking for and wanted to do something very different. And because of that, anyone who didn't fit in with their new thinking, it was a bit of a cultural revolution, really. They were out, you know, they'd gone.
It was awful. We'd had bad times before because the BBC was always cutting back and is always, you know, slimming down and trying to save money. And this was really the worst time because so many people didn't know what was happening, didn't know who was going to stay. They weren't actually allowed to sack anyone, but they did make people, put people into a position where they felt they had to leave.
Arts editor Nick St. George.
When Radio London closed down and became GLR, and that was a very difficult time for a lot of the existing Radio London staff. I think the BBC's put in a very difficult position when it wants to make changes like that. And one can understand, Radio London was an extraordinary radio station. It was a real kind of potpourri of different sorts of programming and different types of presenters and different approaches. But that's not necessarily the way that you get an identity with an audience. There was no real cohesion through Radio London's output towards the end. So I can see why something needed to be done. But the decision was taken to shut Radio London down, have a couple of weeks of just back-to-back music with the odd announcement, but certainly no proper programming, and then start again almost like year zero with what was GLR. And there was a real baby in the bathwater moment. And I think that was possibly not the way through. Take the best of Radio London might have been the better alternative and then mould that into something else. But just kind of slamming the door and pretending almost that the previous X years hadn't existed, I think that was possibly a mistake in retrospect. It was very interesting. I produced the very last show on Radio London that shut the whole thing down, a kind of best of. And I was in the gents in Marylebone High Street with a very senior BBC executive who'd come along to sort of pay his respects at the wake of Radio London. And he said, you know, it's rather good, isn't it? I'm not quite sure why we're closing it down.
Well, that's more or less it. Not only from us, but from this particular radio station.
We must thank all those Radio London people, past and present, who've helped us compile this programme, which was produced by Nick St. George.
Most of all, we've got to thank you for listening. I mean, whether the last 2 hours or the last 18 years, we'd have felt a bit daft without you, and believe you me, we care and love you.
So this is Susie Barnes.
And Mike Sparrow.
And on behalf of all of us here at Radio London, saying goodbye.
Okay, that's a lovely end.
Radio Countdown, 17 days to go.
Trevor, Dan and Matthew Bannister both wanted the station programmes to be made in a slightly different way, which required some technical alterations, but not a lot in the great scheme of things. I think really they wanted to put some clear water between Radio London and GLR. And they had this great idea of just playing music constantly, 24 hours a day. I think there were 10 tapes or something an hour long, which were just rotated round and round and round again, of the sort of music that GLR were going to be playing. The only trouble is, when GLR launched, we got lots of people going, when are you going to put that music back on?
Station editor Matthew Bannister.
I think I'm noted for making changes quite radically, and it's probably not received wisdom in the radio industry of how you do things. But I've always been kind of impatient, and we were under the threat of closure and we needed to make a big statement. And to be honest with you, we did want a different audience to come to this radio station. And we wanted to send a very big signal. And it's not normally the way to do it. You should make radio stations change by stealth.
Programme organiser Trevor Dan.
The idea of the test tapes was very much mine.
because I argued that wrongly, I think now, looking back on it. But then I was passionately convinced that Radio London was a tired and dysfunctional brand that we couldn't do anything with. And I said, as we've got no money for publicity, what would get us some publicity would be if we shut it down. If it was BBC shuts down Radio London and just plays music, that'll get us in the papers. Well, it did. And it also got rid of probably, you know, a million listeners, which probably wasn't such a clever move.
On 94.9 FM and 1458 AM, this is a test transmission for Greater London Radio. Programmes begin at 6.30 on Tuesday morning, the 25th of October, with the fastest news and travel, the best music, the best names and the best sound on London's first new station for 15 years. From Tuesday, 25th of October, Greater London Radio.
It was a terrible name, and of course, as soon as the GLC was ended, it was a ludicrous name. So it had no right to carry on. I mean, one of the things that I do regret is that I think by turning Radio London off, which we did for 2 weeks, and just playing records, I think we missed an opportunity to keep some people and to keep the brand. I think we could probably have changed the sort of brand image of Radio London into GLR without changing its name. And I don't think actually it's been helpful throughout the 40 years that it's been Radio London and then it was GLR and now it's BBC London, and it's constantly changing its name is not terribly helpful, really. It's just Radio London is really what it is, and it probably should have stayed that all along. But I think that what's successfully been maintained is the notion that London isn't the same as everywhere else, and you know, and if you transport a very successful station like BBC Radio Shropshire and put it in the middle of West One, it will sound ridiculous. And I think BBC London has successfully, partly because of the heritage of GLR, fought off the notion that it is just another BBC local station that's part of a network of local stations. It clearly has a different job to do.
This is Greater London Radio, and as I'm sure you will have noticed by now, we the BBC have been paying you the patronised, the seamless blend of fabby music and white on grooves. Lay that on my jive granny. Sorry to say that all this changes, as from 6.30 in the morning, Tuesday the 25th of October, interruptions to the music will then be performed by a host of celebrities and stars, and also appearing will be Nick, who he, Abbott, Emma, oh my god, Freud, Johnny, who him, Walker, Timbo the Bimbo, and Tommy, no, seriously, Vance. Sorry, it is the best we could come up with the budget available, and at least, thank god, you won't be forced to look at them. Actually, that's not quite true, since you may well have seen some of their pictures in the local press. Here's a tip, you can tell which bit is the face because it's the one with the ears and the occasional nose. GLR, as heard but not seen in London, as from 6.30 in the morning, Tuesday the 25th of October. 2 days and counting.
This is GLR. The greatest music, the latest news for London from the BBC. Rock and rolling news.
Headlines at 12.30, I'm Charlotte Franks. London Underground has launched an investigation after 12 District Line trains were removed from service due to safety concerns. Engineers discovered suspected cracks on brackets during a routine inspection of the fleet. An inquiry into why police shot dead a man during a surveillance operation in North London 5 years ago began and was immediately adjourned today. Azelle Rodney was shot 6 times by an undercover police marksman 5 years ago. The inquiry is being held behind closed doors because of secret police evidence, something his family has criticised. A man accused of the murder of the schoolgirl Millie Dowler 8 years ago has appeared at the Old Bailey. Levi Belfield is alleged to have kidnapped the teenager in Walton-on-Thames in Surrey before killing her. He remains in custody and will face trial in May. London's weather, some rain at first, but becoming mostly dry later on. We'll have a top temperature of 18 Celsius, that's 64 Fahrenheit. Those are the headlines. Now here's Jules.
Thanks, Charlotte. One lane closed off with a vehicle fire on the M25 clockwise, 29 to 30. Queues are back to the A12 at 28. Anti-clockwise is slow in the roadworks, 22 to 19 towards Watford. Lights are on local control for the Blackwall Tunnel. Southbound, you might find a few queues on the approaches there. Busy for the West Cross Route northbound at the northern roundabout, the Westway. That's approaching, was down to one lane approaching the roadworks there, so queues are back to the southern roundabout. Broken down vehicle has left some queues for Hyde Park Corner at Grosvenor Place. There's flooding for the Piccadilly underpass, so busy westbound at Hyde Park Corner. All lanes have reopened though. Also, Bowes Road, the North Circular eastbound, slow into the roadworks around the Brownlow Road junction. Queues westbound for the A10 for the North Circular, rather, from the A10 to Green Lanes at Clockhouse, and the A501, one lane blocked off for recovery work for a broken down lorry. That's the Euston Road eastbound at Euston Square. Queues back on Marylebone Road to Great Portland Street. District line suspended, Kensington Olympia to Earls Court. Delays on the rest of the line as well, and there are also delays on the Circle, Hammersmith and City and Metropolitan lines. And Victoria Line's not stopping at Warren Street because of faulty escalators. That's it for me, but I'm back just before one.
Celebrating 40 years of BBC London.
I'm not sure what I'm doing, which isn't altogether unusual for me, but, yes, look, we'll have a little bit of music while I sort myself up, because this could be rather embarrassing if I carry on rustling paper like this. Music, please. Thank heavens for little jingles.
London's radio station for 40 years. This is BBC London 94.9.
This is Greater London Radio. Could say a lot of things like, this is the BBC with the first new legal station in London for 15 years. Or, a revolution in broadcasting has now begun. Or, what about, and we're off and running with a brand new sound. Well, I'd say any of that, I think we should just get on with it. On GLR on 94.9 FM and 1458 AM, I'm Nick Abbott. Morning.
The opening of GLR was completely bizarre. We needed an extra week because we weren't ready, frankly. And if we'd had an extra week, or in fact two, we could have opened on 8/11/88, which would have been quite a cool day to open. But in fact, we opened on 25/10/88, which was not so good. And it was decided by Keith Clement, who was the sort of head of the region, that the opening would have to be on the television. So it was on London Tonight or whatever it was called then. So we had to bring everybody in, all the presenters, and, as it were, mock up the opening of the station with Johnny Walker saying, ah, welcome to the brand new sound of GLR, or whatever he said.
On 94.9 FM and 1458 AM and on London Plus, this for the first time is Greater London Radio. The station you've been waiting for, GLR, is on the air. Johnny Walker and the gang until 8 o'clock, starting off with Bruce Springsteen and Born to Run.
And then we just shut down again until the following morning when we did the opening for real. And we had reporters there and we had bunting and I think we probably had champagne and corks were a-popping. And it was absolutely pathetic, and it just did not do the job at all. And I was not on it. If you look at the tape, I'm not there, because I sat upstairs thinking, this is not what I wanted to be involved with at all. We were trying to launch some cool new brand, and we were launching it as though we were Blue Peter. As for the choice of the record, that was mine. I just thought, well, what's the best record ever made in the history of the world? It's Born to Run. Well, we'll play that then.
Station editor Matthew Bannister. And we got a phone call, actually, from someone called Danny Baker, who was then known for his performances on the local London television station doing the 6 o'clock show. And he said, I fancy this radio stuff. He rang up Trevor Dan and said, you know, I'd like to do radio. Can I have a go? And we thought, well, he's very London. You know, he's very original. Why don't we get him on board too?
I think 6 o'clock show was coming to an end, and I just had an enormous VAT bill. And I hadn't paid it. And so I decided to take every job and get myself an agent for the first time. And I knew Emma Freud, who worked here. And she said, you should come and work at the station. And she put in a word, I think it was Emma who did. And I came here and met with Trevor Dan, And they were kind of impressed by my low-wattage celebrity, I suspect. And they asked me to come in and do Saturdays and Sundays. In 1988, this would have been. And I'd never done radio before, but that didn't seem to bother them. I've often told the story that they got some lanky red-headed kid just down from Manchester called Chris Evans to look after me and show me how to work the desk. And he didn't have a show at the time either.
And then there was this strange job interview. We'd advertised for producers to join the station, and we'd had a lot of applications, and we were interviewing people. In the morning, this guy called John Revel came along wearing a very nice tie and a jacket and gave a very good interview, and he went off. And later on, this red-haired guy came along with spectacles, and he did this extraordinary interview. One of the things he'd done was on his application form for the job, in the blurb at the back, he'd put, "Trouble is my middle name." And then you turned it over, on the front it said Christopher Trouble Evans. And so there was this young, geeky, ginger-haired, original guy who just blew us away. He was just so funny and different from everybody else that we'd interviewed that day. And as we got to the end of the job interview, I said to him, "Don't I recognise that tie?" And he said, "Oh, yes, I thought I should wear a tie for a BBC interview, but I don't own one, so I've just borrowed the one that John Revel was wearing earlier on to come in here." And we thought, well, he's great. Let's get him on board, and I'll tell you what we could do. We could get him to produce Danny Baker. And this was a rather explosive combination. So we had Chris Evans producing Danny Baker on the Weekend Breakfast Show, and I'll never forget Danny's first programme, because he started hitting, he'd never done radio before, he started hitting the desk and going like this and going, "This is Raw Meat Radio, there's a new sheriff in town, watch out," and all this sort of stuff. And we'd never heard anything like it, but it just made you laugh, and you were aware that there was something very different going to happen on this radio station.
So when's your baby due, Lou?
11th, nice Saturday.
7 days?
Yes. Yeah, you know something?
What?
I don't think I'm going to be very pregnant for much longer.
Oh, whoa.
Oh, my God, this has never happened before. You're not having it now. Oh, no.
Are you feeling a bit...
Oh, honey.
Oh, my God.
You better go, hadn't you?
I think I better.
Oh, yeah!
That's the first time.
Louise!
I'm Paul Kenyon, and I was at Radio London, first of all, as a kind of trainee all-round dog's body, do anything for anybody and hero worship people like Tony Blackburn. And I was also there as a producer for GLR about 4 or 5 years after that. When I was interviewed for GLR, they said to me, Trevor Dan, who, you know, famous broadcaster, suddenly said, "Just tell me, what would you do if Queen were playing in London and you suddenly heard they were doing a secret gig and you had to get hold of their, you had to get one of them on air?" And I thought, this is the kind of question for me, because I'm so determined, I absolutely won't let this go. So I said, I've phoned up the venue where they're playing. And Trevor Dan said, we've already tried that, and the venues, all the phones are off. So I said, I'd phone up maybe somebody at GLR, like Tommy Vance or somebody like that, who might have a connection. And they said, "We tried Tommy, he's not there either." So they said, "You know what you would do, Paul? What you should do is phone the agent straight away." And I said, "Yeah, I tried the agent and they weren't there." And I remember Trevor Dan turned around and he said, "Touché." And I thought, I've got the job.
I'm Robert Elms. I currently present a midday show 5 days a week, 3 hours a day. And I have done for something like 16 years. I wish someone had counted, because then I would actually know. But it's something approaching that, I think. I actually got asked to sit in for somebody for 6 weeks one summer. I was already a broadcaster. I'd been presenting shows on Radio 4 and Radio 5, so I was fairly kind of established. And they asked if I would come and sit in for Johnny Walker, I think, because he was taking 6 weeks off in the summer. And I did, and I'm still here. I don't quite know what happened. I was only meant to do this for 6 weeks. But still, it's been fantastic.
Well, I don't think you can buy great talent and then sit on it. You know, you have to give people room to breathe. And I always took the view that our job really was to be impresarios, to say, here is some airtime, you have the talent, off you go.
You did radio for radio's sake. And looking around the country, there's very few even local radio stations that will do that. They're all terrified. And in my experience, they're all looking for jobs on commercial radio, which would be an anathema to me. I've tried it. I couldn't imagine it working, because there's not that courage and there's not that freedom anywhere else. Which is not to suggest this is, you know, come see, come side. There's a very, you know, strict editorial policy behind it. But they know sometimes, well, we don't know why this works, but the audience seem to like it and just let it go. And that is almost revolutionary, almost unique, I think, in British radio now.
what you just heard was a present which Danny Baker very kindly gave to me. I was visibly moved. Danny Baker's still on 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings, by the way. Record it whilst you can. The tapes will be worth thousands one day.
It was a bit of a breakaway faction from the rest of the BBC, if you like, and it really attracted mavericks. These were often people who'd worked on things like Radio Caroline and some of the old output, and had come and found, you know, Radio London as a sort of home for people who had, you know, who'd been, you know, maverick, outrageous behaviour, people who really were chance takers, risk takers, all that kind of thing. And they weren't really going to go and work on, you know, I don't know, Radio Herefordshire or Radio Worcestershire. It was Radio London. It had a real pulse and a real beat about it, and it did feel as though it was distinct from the rest of the BBC. And I think, actually, what made it very distinct was it was just the people who worked on it, and it was just having somebody like Tony Blackburn, and knowing that he wasn't going to be so rigidly controlled as he would have been in other areas of the BBC. He knew, actually, that there was a lot of freedom there, and there was the freedom to do pretty much as he wanted, and that freedom is what attracted a lot of people.
At the time, GLR was just the best place to work in the business, I think. There was no money. We had a sense that we were creating something new and different, and that we would allow talented people to experiment, even if they failed. There were things that we got wrong, there were things that people did wrong, but there were brilliant, brilliant programmes made, and there was an amazing atmosphere. There was a sense of all of us in a house together having ideas and putting them on the radio. You know, and when Chris Morris came on the station, I mean, he was making radio the like of which you haven't heard before. And he was offending some people and doing some things that were, you know, near the edge of what was acceptable. But I thought he was an absolutely brilliant talent, and that therefore he was going to get my support.
I am not here. I am not here. I'm not here. This is a piece of tape. I am not here. I'm not here, but if you see the manager of the station, a man called Trevor Dan, perhaps he could pass on the information that I'm not here. This is specifically for him. The last communique he had from me, you may remember him, by the way, from last summer, from the early morning procedure, or the mid-morning procedure, with the, you may know him as Uncle Trevor. Hello, everybody! He's now the manager of the station. This was the last communique he had from me.
Good morning.
Trevor!
Yeah?
Chris Morris.
Good Lord, man, how are you?
I'm very well. Just thought I'd let you know you asked me to do a programme today.
Yeah?
Well, I think you just become the biggest April Fool of your life, mate. I'm in Scotland. You've got about 10 minutes to find someone to do a show.
Ho ho.
No kidding.
What?
No kidding. You didn't seriously think I'd come in, did you?
He rings me up and says, you didn't think I'd come in, did you? I think it's very likely that he would have done it twice to me. Yes, that was his style.
GLR was an absolute blast to work at in those days. I'm talking about 20 years ago. Mary Costello, wife of Elvis Costello, was presenting one show in the middle of the night. Tommy Vance was there, larking about of blessed memory, an incredibly talented, a legend already in those days. And there was a kind of feeling of adventure and excitement, and that you were, in a way, sailing through uncharted waters, and that it was a really, really exciting place to be.
I knew it wasn't right to have the back door always open and to turn up in my studio and there'd be literally 12 to 15 strangers sitting there. There'd be 12 to 15 strangers. One show, I didn't talk the first hour. I was so furious. And they were all just there to hang out. But there was no security. None. None. And the back door was broken. And people just used to walk in. I used to walk in of a morning. I'd just walk in with my bags. If that door went open, shove this one. It used to give way and you'd walk in. But whether it, you know, that's all part of the legend, the lore, and it sounds very golden there, but it didn't, at the time, you just thought it was this this ramshackle old pirate ship that was barely staying afloat, which of course it was. But it was really was a bit of a doss house as well. It was a little bit of a doss house that the BBC could and perhaps should have shut down at any time.
Well, I don't remember it being quite like that. I think Radio London, when Tony Blackburn was there, was a bit more open door. And it was literally open door because, of course, they had a shop.
When I first started the job, I thought I should wear a dirty raincoat and turn up the collar because the window of Radio London was full of wet-look Tony Blackburn knickers.
What did that shop sell? I mean, it used to have these old T-shirts with, I don't know, with Radio London and then the whatever the wavelength was at the time written on the front. It wasn't even properly lit. But I'll tell you, the thing about that shop at the front was that just behind it, Radio London always managed to have, they had a long desk and they always managed to employ the most beautiful girls in the whole of South East England. And people would just come in and I think people used to come and hang around just to see the kind of models behind the counter. And they would wear a Radio London T-shirt and they'd probably come out to road shows and stuff like that.
I was big into New Country, so having people like Lyle Lovett and Steve Earle and Nancy Griffiths and these people just coming in and setting up downstairs was a complete joy. And, you know, later on, you know, as we moved in towards Britpop, you know, hey, Oasis playing live in the studio, unbelievable.
18 months ago, you were playing at the 100 Club, Saturday and Sunday, 40,000 people at the Earls Court Arena.
Don't know.
Where did it all go right?
Where did it all go right? It's all down to Gary Crowley. We owe that. We owe our career to that man.
They call me the star maker here at GLR.
They do. And the check's in the post, guys. You know what I mean?
The 90s Huey Green. Now, what else are you going to play for us?
I'm going to play Don't Look Back in Anger. Outfit Kids. Right, I'm going to do it now.
Okay.
Bye.
The interview was on a Thursday evening when we were moved to weekday evenings for the programme. Noel did an hour where he was co-presenting and also choosing the music. And then in the second hour, he went downstairs with his acoustic guitar and, you know, did songs from What's the Story.
You said that you've never been.
One of the things that used to happen is that GLR and Radio London could always punch well above its weight. They could get superstars on. They'd get Johnny Rotten on, they'd get the whole of the Jam came in one day. You know, they'd get these amazing bands, and actually all the journalists there were secretly really into their music as well. That's why we liked the station. So you'd say, you know, the word would get round that somebody like Johnny Rotten was coming in. And I remember Paul Weller coming in, and everybody abandoned the newsroom and we would just go into the central studio and everybody would just stand around. The news was entirely forgotten and everybody would just be into the music. We'd stand around and watch and think it was fantastic. And that, I mean, that's one of the reasons that a lot of journalists wanted to work at GLR or Radio London. Nothing to do with whether it was a good news patch. They just had great music.
So Crowley can wait, 'cause he knows it's too late as I'm walking on by. His show
sitting upstairs, sort of rubbing my hands and going, great, I've got a jingle out of him.
Presenter Phil Jupitus.
I'm very fond of that studio for two reasons. Firstly, because I was the man on duty when they had the last ever gig by Crowded House. Problem being, I don't really like Crowded House. There is freedom within. I remember one thing I do remember very clearly, because it's a show that I listened to, was when there was a woman, Jane something, I know, was a thing, who kind of proposed the fact that there were going to be changes to GLR to meet his broadcasting remit, you know, which is fair enough. It had a job to play to community and it was going to become more speech-based. And, of course, the people that listen to GLR and love GLR, you know, the shorthand for the station in the late 90s was it was Radio 4 with pop records. You had intelligent chat and really, really good music. The like of which Radio 2 wouldn't play and the like of which Radio 1 wouldn't play. And so it was this unique thing. And people were very, very, very protective of it.
Because I've been here for a very long time, I've seen a lot of changes in the nature of the station. And you get kind of edicts from above. Right, we're going... First of all, it was a rock and roll station, which was never really my thing. And it was great. There was some real creativity here.
But for me, coming from Radio 4 and Radio 5, it was rather like trying to present a radio show in a sixth form common room. It was anarchic, it was messy, it was all over the place. People would turn up drunk in their underpants. I mean, I'm not kidding. So these things were genuine. And I was as much to blame as anybody else because I got into the spirit of it. So it was fantastic, but it was damned hard work to try and do a consistent show. So in many respects, I kind of quite enjoyed some of the changes to a slightly more grown-up radio station. And it did change from being primarily music-based and primarily a much younger station than it is now to a slightly more mature, word-based station. And that suited me as a broadcaster.
Matthew Bannister.
Well, I did my 3 years here, and it was quite stressful and difficult time trying to persuade the rest of the BBC that the kind of manic things that we were doing here mattered and were important for the future. And, you know, the culmination of it all was when the Board of Governors were going to discuss the future of GLR, a discussion that I wasn't invited to, and nor was anybody else from the station, but there were bosses upon bosses above us who went to that discussion. And there was no sense in which there was a process to allow us to influence our own future. But I just sort of phoned a few of the BBC governors in a rather sort of frightened way and invited them round. I remember the novelist P.D. James came round. I remember showing her round and telling Chris Evans to keep his boxer shorts firmly buttoned while she was in the building, and sitting down with her and giving her a document I'd written about why GLR was important and why the BBC should support it. And she was incredibly supportive, and eventually the station was saved and it was given the go-ahead. And I felt that to a certain extent I'd done my work here, and I wanted to go out and find out more about the wider BBC. So I went off to work somewhere else, and Trevor Dann took over as managing editor.
We felt that the BBC wasn't on our side. Nobody was on our side. And, of course, long after I left, in my huff saying, well, if that's what you're going to do, I'm leaving, actually, GLR carried on and had a very, you know, had a very creative period. And people like Robert Elms joined, Phil Jupiter's and Mark Lamar and that lot. I didn't hire any of them. They came later.
Station editor David Roby.
When I arrived at the end of 1999, the station was very demoralised because the South East Review had basically written the ending for GLR. So staff were very down. They were very dedicated to that station. So in every sense, the kind of launch time for a new station for London was very bad.
On 94.9 FM, this is BBC London Live.
We've still got that accident.
In 2000, the station was to have yet another name change from GLR to BBC London Live, and later to BBC London 94.9. London Live.
Well, the main thing was to bring in these speech-led programmes, and the key one would be breakfast. Previously, GLR had a music with speech and news programme. This was going to be an all-speech breakfast show.
The 5 o'clock news. Good afternoon, I'm Marcus Churchill.
Interestingly, presented by Paul Ross. And we brought Alice Beer in, who at that time was presenting the breakfast show, or co-presenting the breakfast show on LBC. A decision was made quite early on, a crucial decision, around about January time. And the question was put, do you want to make this into an all-speech or nearly all-speech-based station, or do you believe we should do a transitional change from GLR? I went for the transition because I said that even though GLR's audience at that point was very low, did we want to risk throwing them all out? But I would say we're still transitional.
I'm Pete Stevens, and I'm the sports editor at BBC London, and I've been here since 1994 to date 2010.
Tom Watts. London Live Sports.
Medal for football.
You're in the right.
Since we became BBC London, sport has played a big part in the output of this station. We've taken on board commentaries of all London sides from all divisions for football, for rugby. We've done ball-by-ball cricket, which was an innovation of BBC London's on the website. We covered the field as far as London sport very comprehensively. There was, of course, the Olympic Games announcement. That was an absolutely magical day, and we're still looking forward to doing the Olympics in 2012. But I suppose being part of a team that has been through so many major events with London sport. There's no capital city in the world like London for sport. You just can't keep London out of the news, and BBC London Sport has been right at the forefront of all of it.
I'm Jo Good, and I am the late night presenter, having been the breakfast presenter, having been the overnight presenter and a late night presenter. I'm in my fourth role here at BBC London. I've been here 7 years. Well, I did that whole thing of trying to find my on-air husband for me. So I sat next to endless, I called it sitting next to daddy, all these men who had children, because I didn't have any. So they were desperate to find someone with family values. When you think of the list of suspects, there was Andy Peters, Jason Donovan, who had one hidden somewhere in the Greater Antipodes, who would make fruit salad in the 8 o'clock news and not reappear until the 8:30 headlines. There was Roland Riveron. There was Jono, fantastic Jono, who was like mogadoned up for the first hour, so we never really had a lot out of Jono for between 6 and 7. Then there was, I sat next to Dalton. He was there as well. Who else? Oh, Les Dennis. He came in. So I was just sitting next to Daddy, basically. And then of course, Max Rushton, who, you know, he was reared in that studio to go on and do bigger and better things.
Perhaps the most trying day ever of my time here was the official launch of, I think it was London Live. And the London Eye had recently opened. It was a new innovation. And so we were a new London radio station. This was a new London kind of phenomena. So someone had the very clever idea, and it was quite a good idea, really, to present the entire show from a pod on the London Eye to launch the station. And I was going to do it. Quite proud of that. They chose me to be the person to say, this is a new station for London, all this sort of stuff. So we had to arrive at the London Eye in the morning. I was doing the morning show then. It was 9 o'clock in the morning. And so I got there at 8 o'clock, all good and bright and early. And it so turned up that one of the engineers, who shall remain nameless, but he's called Steve, was meant to be bringing the equipment.
I had taken all the stuff home with me in a little runaround car with the intention of driving it all the way down from my home, which is in Luton, down the M1. And I was in plenty of time. I got up really early. I was on the motorway at whatever time it would be, 6 o'clock, something like that. And there was just traffic chaos, and I could not move. I was on the M1 in this car with the whole of GLR sitting in the back of my car and nowhere to go.
We're meant to be in this pod launching a station, and the equipment isn't there, right? So we had a radio car sitting there by it. So I had to do it in there. So I had to say, we are here at the London Eye presenting an...
I arrived, I charged up there. Our pod, fortunately, was quite close to the ground at this point, so I jumped on, and Robert jumped on, and I turned on my transmitter, and it worked. But I have no idea how. It was horrible.
But I think about now, it's the strongest it's ever been. And I would never say that normally unless I actually thought it. I do think it's the strongest this station has ever been. It works in terms of its brief, and it works in terms of its sense of being apart from other radio stations. Because even if it sounds like one of the other stations, and they've stolen from us, you know, 2 and 4 and all of that, it's still very much very interesting to see who the next few hirings would be. As long as it, for my money, doesn't go down the safe route, because it's never, ever been a safe station. It's been no good. It's been brilliant, but it's never been safe. And the one thing I would ask them to guard against is actually just becoming another little puppet radio station.
Presenting a show like this every day, I'll tell you what stands out, and it isn't one thing. It isn't a famous celebrity. It isn't any of those kind of things. It's the listeners. And that sounds really corny, and it sounds like I'm, you know, doing all that sort of radio presenter stuff. But what's happened is, because of the changes in technology, particularly because of email and because of mobile phones, you just develop this interaction with listeners, which is instantaneous now. And that didn't used to happen when I first came here. You know, that the technologies just didn't exist. And it's really, really heartwarming. Like, there've been times when, you know, I've had things happen in my life. And when you present a show every day, people know all about your life. You know, my son was born when I was on air. My daughters were born. And the responses from listeners are quite extraordinary. I mean, one day that does stick in my mind, in one instance, we were talking about memories of the Second World War, and someone rang up and said, told a memory of something like their uncle or something, who died as a firefighter putting out bombs in the Blitz, and they were going to be, and he wasn't the only one who died, it was the biggest death of firefighters in the Second World War, and they were going to be putting a little plaque up in a square in Bloomsbury, and I remember he ended up in tears, I ended up in tears, and it was just, it was really heartfelt, and to this day I'm almost slightly kind of getting a bit wobbly thinking about it now.
But I do think that's what radio can do. It can. I often don't acknowledge enough the extraordinary both loyalty and in insanity of the audience. But that is what radio can do. And you are not going to get that from Capital. You ain't. You're not going to get it from Magic. You're not going to get it from Generic. You have to do it from the specific, and you have to do it from the free.
So there you have it, 40 years of great radio condensed into 1 hour. And I hope you enjoyed it. And here's to the next 40 years. Up next, Robert Elms will be here, taking your calls and memories of BBC London from the past 40 years. But first, here's the latest news and travel.